All right, so let's take a look at handling events. The simplest of events is a user clicking on something, perhaps a button because they're adding new courses or removing courses or just generating some action. So let's take a look at perhaps right next to each course, add a button that would allow us to perhaps remove that one course. All right, so let's take a look at that. Right. So what we can do is that right next to all these line items, we can create a button. Create a button, and we say maybe delete. Okay. And so to invoke some behavior, we can use the click directive. Just like there's an NG4 directive, there is a click directive, right, that allows us to bind the click event onto an element. And you can bind it to a button, but you can also bind it to the entire LI or to the UL. You can bind it to anything. Any DOM element, you can make it clickable. So here, to specify that this is a directive that is generating an event, right? We use parentheses. Parentheses means this directive is generating an event. Okay, and it takes as argument a function that you want to invoke, right? And so in this particular case, perhaps we might want to delete this element. So we'll say that it says delete course, and we might pass along information about which course are we removing, and what we could pass is, for instance, the ID of the course, right, that which we can then use on the component. We can say course dot ID, right? Notice no curly brackets nor anything, right? This is meant to be parsed by the framework, right? There's no ambiguity whether this is a literal or not, right? This already tells me that what I'm passing along here is an expression. Right? There's no need to put it in curly brackets. So the function gets implemented in the component. Right? The component will implement a function of the same name. Right? So here in the component, we can declare these functions, and they can take as arguments whatever you pass it. Right, so in this case, a course ID. And in here, we can just say, for instance, something as simple as alert and the course ID that we're passing as arguments. So there's the delete button. And if we click on it, it alerts for that particular ID. Okay, ID 345. Right, and then we can do whatever we want with that ID. Right, for instance, in this particular case, we might iterate over the array, right, and then just remove that one element from the array. Okay, or we can generate a brand new array, but without that element in that particular array. Right, that's up to you. This is a plain old array that we're manipulating, and it's up to you how you want to manipulate it. Whatever you do to this courses variable, right, generates an event back to the template that it needs to re-render. It says, hey, something happened to this variable. Somebody touched it. Okay, we need to re-render the DOM. Right? So what we can do is we can say courses. We can regenerate it. We can say this.courses. Okay, we can regenerate it by saying perhaps this.courses. We can do what? We do a filter, so here's course in the filter, and so we want the elements in the course if it's different than the ID, right? So we're going to return. Actually, no. If it's a return, we don't need the curly bracket, right? We're just going to say return course.id. Is different than the actual course ID that you're passing me as argument. Right? Is that Am I missing something? Oh, semicolon here. So if we go back and we click on 5610, notice that it's gone, right? So it's filtering over that array, and it's only keeping the ones that are not the course equal to the course ID. Right? You could have used a for loop and created a brand new array, okay, and then assigned it to courses, and then it would have rendered it. That makes sense? Everybody good? Yes. Yeah, even if an attribute changes. So anything you touch in that array, it causes a re-render. Right, so even if you have a nested object, right, and you change a little attribute down here, right, it causes an event to be sent over to the rendering engine, and it re-renders. Right, it re-renders on the fly. Yep, which is pretty cool. So there's very little ambiguity whether the DOM will render or not, right? If the object that is attached changes in any way, it notifies anybody who has any interest in this. Notice that the 3 also changed, right? Notice that the 3 changed as well, right? Because it's the array variable changed, its length changed, and it triggered an update on that length. Okay. All right. So let's add another one. For instance, maybe we want to. Have here an add button that if we click it, we want to add a course. Okay, so this is add course, and this will be calling a course, and it could take as argument maybe the title of the course, maybe new course. Okay, and so here we could have a function that handles that. We say add course, and it takes here the course title. And then what it'll do is that it'll take that title and perhaps push it into the array. So let's see. We could say this dot courses push, and then a new object whose title is the course title that you're passing me as argument. And the ID, for now, will be just some bogus ID. Okay? Right, notice what's happening is that we are modifying that array. Okay? Because I'm modifying that array, it will trigger an event for the DOM to be re-rendered. Okay? So if we come here and we press on add course, notice that it adds one, right, it just pushes that array and re-renders the entire array. Notice also the course's length is rendered at the top as well. Okay. And these two can be, now the, notice that it removed all of them because they all had the same ID, right? It removed all of them, so it filtered them all the ones, right? If we want to perhaps to know what the ID, we could have a local variable that we can increment perhaps, right? So that it could be unique. Now, the more interesting thing would be that instead of passing this hard-coded element here, we could perhaps have an input field where we can type the new title of that course, right? And we can pass it as an argument over here, right? So to do that, we would need to use some kind of form or some input field where we can read the value of that variable, right? And then pass it here as an argument. Right, so to do that, we'll need to load the form module. Unfortunately, the forms are not supported out of the box. You need to import the forms module to handle forms. So let's do that next.